Good evening. 70 years ago tonight, on March 28, 1946, Albert Camus stood on this stage in McMillin Theatre and delivered a lecture on La Crise de l'Homme, the human crisis. He had written it on the ship crossing the Atlantic for his first and only voyage to the United States. Camus lectured in French, he knew almost no English, and he was joined on stage by Vercors and Timeret, two fellow writers of the French Resistance. 1,500 people packed into McMillin Theater that night. Justin O'Brien, the Columbia French professor who was master of ceremonies and who later became Camus' translator, wrote that no American Francophile could remember any lecture in French that had drawn an audience of more than 300 in New York. This was the signature French intellectual event of the post-war era for New York and for Columbia. For tonight's reading, we had even more than 1,500 people signed up when we closed the wait list. So it's clear that Albert Camus remains a big draw in 2016, especially when Camus is played by Viggo Mortensen. This event is presented by the Columbia Maison Française and the Albert Camus Estate as part of Camus, A Stranger in the City, a festival taking place in New York to celebrate the 70th anniversary of Camus' U.S. trip. I'm the director of the Maison Française, Shanny Pierre, and I'd like to thank the Albert Camus Estate, Catherine Camus and Alexandre, the Florence Gould Foundation as a festival sponsor and major benefactor of the Maison Française, Melissa Smay and Miller Theater, and everyone else involved in this event. And I know that all of us would like to thank Viggo Mortensen, Alice Kaplan, and Souleymane Bachir Diagne for generously sharing their time and talent to be here tonight to give voice to Albert Camus' reflections on a world in moral crisis, reflections that remain so resonant today. Viggo Mortensen is an internationally acclaimed actor whose films include The Two Faces of January, A Dangerous Method, The Road, Eastern Promises, A History of Violence, and the Lord of the Rings trilogy. He recently starred in Loin des Hommes, Far From Men, which we just screened this afternoon, a film set in Algeria in 1954 that is an adaptation of Camus' short story, The Guest. Viggo Mortensen speaks French and Arabic in Far From Men. In fact, his French is so good that he proposed some masterful refinements to the translation of The Human Crisis that he'll be reading this evening. Viggo Mortensen has received awards and nominations from many groups, including the Screen Actors Guild, the American Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, and the British Academy of Film and Television Arts. He's also a painter, a poet, a photographer, and founding editor of Percival Press. Like Camus, Viggo Mortensen is an engaged artist, and he also shares Camus' deep antipathy for violence and war. He's spoken out actively against the Iraq War and has opposed the continued presence of the US military in Afghanistan. After the lecture, Viggo Mortensen will be joined on stage by Souleymane Bachir Diagne and Alice Kaplan to discuss Camus' speech and his reception in the US. So I'll now introduce them briefly before we begin. Souleymane Bachir Diagne is professor of French and philosophy and chair of the Department of French at Columbia University. He's a specialist of the history of philosophy, Islamic philosophy, and African philosophy and literature. His many honors include the Edouard Glissant Prize and the Lenfest Distinguished Columbia Faculty Award. Alice Kaplan is professor and chair of the French department at Yale University. Her areas of interest include literary life during the Nazi occupation of France and post-war history and fiction. Professor Kaplan's newest book, Looking for the Stranger, Albert Camus and the Life of a Literary Classic, will be published next fall. Drawing on her research, Professor Kaplan will now set the scene for Viggo Mortensen's reading of The Human Crisis. One last point. Please remember that in 1946, people didn't have iPhones or Instagram or Twitter. And indeed, there's not a single photograph and no recording of Camus' 1946 lecture. Tonight, we are filming and we'll share the video with you on the Maison Française website. But I'd like to remind you now that no photography or recording of any kind is otherwise permitted tonight, and that all personal electronic devices, including cell phones and tablets, should be completely turned off. Thank you.
Let's imagine the scene that late March evening of 1946. On stage, three writers represent the spirit of the French Resistance. France, cut off from the rest of the world during 4 years of Nazi occupation, has been free for a single year, struggling to find its way. How many people in the New York audience had relatives deported from France who never returned? How many had made it out of the country just in time? How many were veterans of the North African landing or the liberation of Paris? Nicolas Chiaramonti was there. He'd flown in Malraux's squadron in the Spanish Civil War, escaped Europe through Oran, where Camus was his host. Now he was writing for the New Republic. Jacques Chiffrin was there, too, forced out of his job at Gallimard Publishers by the anti-Jewish laws and exiled in New York, where he founded Pantheon Books. Whether they were Americans or French in exile, New Yorkers were starved for news from France. They wanted to hear about the recovery, but even more, they wanted to know what moral and ethical conclusions could be drawn from what had taken place. The three men on stage represented the intellectual standards of a struggle against evil, but no one more than Albert Camus. A decade younger than the other speakers, Camus, at age 32, was the star editorial writer for Combat, a daily newspaper whose motto was, "From resistance to the revolution." Army veterans, in a show of support, came to the lecture carrying copies of Combat they had brought home from France. In a week, Knopf would publish the first English translation of Camus' 1942 novel, The Stranger. In a full-page ad in Publishers Weekly, Knopf was promising an existentialist revelation. Camus had been in New York for 3 days. The trip began badly. When his ship, the SS Oregon, docked in the New York Harbor on March 25th, he was detained by immigration officials for 4 hours of questioning, to which he responded with utter silence until a young attaché from French Cultural Services came to rescue him. J. Edgar Hoover had gotten word of his arrival and asked an agent to investigate his possible links to the Communist Party. Now, the FBI's most reliable source turned out to be an article in The Nation by Hannah Arendt, explaining that existentialist writers were having more fun than anyone, writing serious philosophical novels that read like detective stories. The Columbia student newspaper, too, promised in a March 26 article that Camus appears to live happily within the absurd and not to sacrifice his lucidity and contentedness at the altar of metaphysical revelation. Justin O'Brien, Camus' host in the Columbia French department, called him the boldest writer in France today. Camus was on an official government mission to promote French culture, and he answered to Claude Lévi-Strauss, the great anthropologist who directed the cultural services of the French embassy in New York. "Exclusively literary topics, please," the young writer was warned. "I never thought my talks in the US would be of a political nature," Camus replied. "Of course I can talk about strictly literary matters, but I really don't think that any of the artistic problems of the day can be considered apart from their human consequences." They finally settled on a general topic, the human crisis, that could be as literary or philosophical as he wanted. A French friend in New York warned Camus that Americans don't like ideas. "That's what they say," he wrote in his diary. I'm not so sure. He was incapable of talking down to any audience. And indeed, the concrete examples in his talk are shored up with challenging abstractions, references to the Hegelian dialectic and the absurd. 600 people were expected at the McMillin Theater. 1,500 showed up, crowding every available space. Proceeds from modest ticket sales were supposed to go to a fund for French war orphans, but someone stole the cash box. Professor O'Brien made an announcement, and people dug into their pockets to replace the stolen funds. Camus was struck by the New Yorkers' generosity. Their hospitality, their cordiality are like that too, he noted, spontaneous and without affectation. It's what's best in them. Like Viggo Mortensen, Albert Camus was an editor, an artist, and an actor, a seasoned performer. In the evening, a little stage fright, he reported in his diary, but I throw myself into it right away, and the public is hooked. Please join me now in welcoming Viggo Mortensen, reading Albert Camus' The Human Crisis.
Well, the theater has been renovated since 1946, but it is the same spot. It's a unique honor to be allowed to read an English translation of Albert Camus' La Crise de l'Homme for you tonight on the recommendation of Catherine Camus, the author's daughter, 70 years to the day that he gave the speech in the same theater. The reason for reading it in English is so that a maximum number of those present might understand the words. Hopefully the spirit of the original text will be seen to have been respected. Some things have changed in the intervening 70 years, as they naturally will. On the 28th of March, 1946, audience members were charged 60 cents for admission, and students only 30 cents. The date that year fell on a Thursday, while this one falls on a Monday. And, well, for what it might be worth, I was born in this city on a Monday. If you want, it's surrealism. To throw that in. And it was raining, as it was this morning. So I'm told. What has also changed since that night in 1946 is the audience for Camus' speech, and presumably its expectations, worldviews, and understanding of the author and his work. One thing that holds true today, as it did 70 years ago, is the fact that a person needs great courage, especially in a time of war, or post-war, to take an unwavering position of resistance to violence and murder of any kind. As Camus said, aucune cause ne justifie le meurtre des innocents. No cause justifies the murder of innocents. His speech, given here as the seeds of the Cold War and McCarthyism were virulently germinating, points prophetically to the geopolitical conflicts and to the problems of fanaticism, intolerance, and dehumanization that we continue to face today. I, by speaking his words tonight, and you, by listening to them, bear witness to a stubbornly pure statement in favor of truthful discourse and peaceful human interaction. Tonight's reading, I dare to generally dedicate to every individual who promotes peaceful communication, even with the smallest gesture of respect or a willingness to at least listen to others. In particular, I'd like to recognize in that regard another politically and philosophically engaged writer from Algeria, Tahar Jaout. In 1993, the year he was murdered by the so-called armed Islamic group for speaking out against fanaticism and violence and in favor of secularism, Tahar Jaout was credited with the following words. Le silence, c'est la mort. Et toi, si tu te tais, tu meurs. Et si tu parles, tu meurs. Alors dis et meurt. Silence is death. If you remain silent, you die. And if you speak, you die. So speak and die. Camus also gave the speech, I'm told, at Brooklyn College and at Harvard. And on those occasions, he made some pre-speech remarks, although he is said to have omitted them when he spoke here. I'm going to include them tonight because they allude, not without his characteristic humor, to the difficult negotiations he had with the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who sponsored his spring 1946 lecture tour. The ministry was apparently concerned that he would be too political and wanted him to stick exclusively to the subjects of theater and literature. I apologize for making a relatively long speech, just a little longer, but I think it'll be of historical interest to some of you to have that preamble as well. Mesdames, Messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, when I was invited to give a series of lectures in the United States of America, I felt some doubt and hesitation. I'm really not old enough to give lectures, and I am more at ease with the process of thinking than I am making categorical statements, since I don't feel I have any claim on what is generally called the truth. I shared these reservations and was very politely told that my personal opinion didn't matter. What mattered was that I be able to offer some facts about France so that my listeners could form their own opinions. It was then suggested that I might inform my audience as to the current state of the French theater, French literature, and even French philosophy. I replied that it might be more interesting to talk about the extraordinary efforts of French railway workers, or about the kind of work the coal miners in the north are doing. But I was then told, quite rightly, that one should never force one's talent, and that these different subjects ought to be discussed by the experts. Since I clearly know nothing about railroad switches, and had I been interested in literary questions, and I had been interested in literary questions for a long time, it was only natural to speak about literature rather than trains. At last, I understood. What mattered finally was that I talk about what I know and give some sense of what is happening in France. For precisely that reason, I have chosen to speak neither about literature nor about theater. Literature, theater, philosophy, research, and the efforts of an entire nation are merely reflections of a fundamental question, of a struggle for life and for humanity that preoccupies us in this moment. The French people sense that mankind is still under threat, and they also sense that to continue living, they must rescue a certain idea of mankind from the crisis that grips the whole world. Out of loyalty to my country, I've chosen to speak about this human crisis. Since I'm here to talk about what I know, the best I can do is sketch as clearly as I can the moral experience of my generation. Because we have seen the entire world crisis unfold, and our experience might shed a glimmer of light, both on the fate of mankind and on some aspects of the sensibilities of the French people today. First, I'd like to define this generation for you. The human crisis, March 28th, 1946. People of my age in France and in Europe were born either before or during the First Great War, reached adolescence during the worldwide economic depression, and turned 20 the year of Hitler's rise to power. To complete their education, next came the Civil War in Spain, the Munich Agreements, the start of another world war in 1939, the fall of France in 1940, and 4 years of enemy occupation and underground struggle. I suppose this is what's known as an interesting generation, and that it would be more useful to speak to you not in my own name, but in the name of a certain number of French people who are 30 years old today and whose intelligence and hearts were formed during the terrible years when, like their country, they were nourished on shame and lived by rebellion. Yes, this is an interesting generation. Faced with the absurd world its elders had concocted, it believed in nothing and yearned to rebel. The literature of its time was in revolt against lucidity, against narrative, and against the very idea of a sentence. Painting was abstract, that is to say, it was rebelling against figurativism, realism, and simple harmony. Music was rejecting melody And as for philosophy, it taught us that there was no truth, only phenomena, that Mr. Smith, Monsieur Durand, and Herr Vogel might all exist as phenomena, but without these three particular phenomena having anything in common. The moral attitude of our generation was even more categorical. Nationalism seemed an outmoded truth, and religion an escape. 25 years of international politics had taught us to question any notion of purity, and to conclude that no one was ever wrong because everyone might be right. As for our society's traditional morality, it seemed to us that it hadn't stopped being what it had always been, a monstrous hypocrisy. Thus, we lived in negation. Of course, that was nothing new. Other generations and other countries have experienced this in other periods of history. But what is new here is that these same men, strangers to any traditional values, had been forced to adapt their personal positions to a context of murder and terror. The situation led them to believe there might be a human crisis, as they had to live the most wrenching of contradictions. This was because they entered the war as one enters hell, if it is true that hell is denial. They loved neither war nor violence, yet they had to accept war and practice violence. They hated nothing except hatred, yet they were forced to learn that difficult science. They had to deal with terror, or rather terror dealt with them. They found themselves confronted with a situation that, rather than try to describe it in general terms, I would like to illustrate through four short stories about a time the world is beginning to forget, but which still burns in our hearts. One, in an apartment building occupied by the Gestapo in a European capital, two accused men, still bleeding, find themselves tied up after a night of interrogation. The concierge of the building begins her careful household chores, in good spirits, since she probably just finished breakfast. Reproached by one of the tortured men, she replies indignantly, "I never interfere with my tenant's business." Two, in Lyon, one of my comrades is dragged from his cell for a third round of questioning. Since his ears have been badly torn during a previous session, he is wearing a bandage around his head. The German officer who interrogates him is the same man who had conducted the previous sessions, and yet he asks him with an air of affectionate concern, "How are your ears doing?" Three, in Greece, after an underground resistance operation, a German officer prepares the execution of three brothers he has taken as hostages. Their old mother throws herself at his feet, and he agrees to save one of them, but only on the condition that she designate which one. She chooses the oldest because he has a family, but her choice condemns the two others, just as the German officer intended. Four. A group of deported women, including one of our comrades, is repatriated to France by way of Switzerland. As soon as they enter Swiss territory, they notice a funeral taking place, and the mere sight of this spectacle sets off their hysterical laughter. "That's how the dead are treated here," they say. I've chosen these stories because they allow me to respond with something other than a conventional yes to the question, is there a human crisis? They allow me to reply, just as the men I was speaking about replied, yes, there is a human crisis because in today's world, we can contemplate the death or the torture of a human being with a feeling of indifference, friendly concern, scientific interest, or simple passivity. Yes, there is a human crisis, since putting a person to death can be regarded with something other than the horror and scandal it ought to provoke. Since human suffering is accepted as a somewhat boring obligation, on a par with getting supplies or having to stand in line for an ounce of butter. It's too easy in this matter to simply accuse Hitler and say that since the beast is dead, its venom is gone. We know perfectly well that the venom is not gone, that each of us carries it in our own hearts. And we can sense this by the way that nations, political parties, and individuals continue to regard one another with the vestiges of anger. I have always believed that a nation is accountable for its traitors as well as for its heroes. But likewise, civilizations, the white man's civilization in particular, are as responsible for their perversions as for their successes. In this light, we are all answerable for the legacy of Hitler and must attempt to discover the most general causes of the terrible evil that has eaten away at the face of Europe. Let us try then, with the help of the four stories I have told, to enumerate the most obvious symptoms of the crisis. The first symptom is the rise of terror, a consequence of the perversion of values through which human beings and historical forces are judged not in terms of their dignity, but in terms of their success. The modern crisis is inevitable because no one in the West can be sure about their immediate future, and all live with the more or less defined fear that they will be crushed to bits one way or another by history. To save this miserable man, this modern-day Job, from perishing of his wounds on his own dunghill, we must first lift the burden of fear and anxiety so he can rediscover the freedom of thought he'll need to resolve any of the problems facing the modern conscience. This crisis is also based on the impossibility of persuasion. People can only really live if they believe they have something in common, something that brings them together. If they address someone humanely, they expect a humane response. However, we have discovered that certain men cannot be persuaded. A victim of the concentration camps could not hope to explain to the SS men who were beating him that they ought not to. The Greek mother I spoke about could not persuade the German officer that he had no right to force her into heartbreak. The SS and the German officer no longer represented men or mankind, but rather an instinct elevated to the status of an idea or a theory. Passion, even deadly passion, would have been preferable. For passion runs its course, and another passion, another cry from the flesh or the heart, might replace it. But a man capable of tender concern for ears that he has only recently torn is not passionate. He is a mathematical calculation that cannot be restrained or reasoned with. This crisis is also about replacing real things with printed matter. That is to say, the growth of bureaucracy. Contemporary man tends more and more to put between himself and nature an abstract and complex machinery that casts him into solitude. Only when there is no more bread do bread coupons appear. The people of France subsist on 1,200 calorie a day diet, but they have at least 6 different forms and 100 official stamps on each one of those forms. It's the same way everywhere where bureaucracy is expanding. To get from France to America, I used a lot of paper in both places, so much paper that I could have probably printed enough copies of this talk to have it distributed here without having to show up. With so much paper, so many offices and functionaries, we are creating a world in which human warmth has disappeared, where no one can come into contact with anyone else except across a maze of what we call formalities. The German officer who spoke with care of the shredded ears of my comrade thought this was fine, since tearing them was part of his official business, and there could not, therefore, be anything wrong with it. In sum, one no longer dies, one no longer loves, and one no longer kills, except by proxy. This, I suppose, is what is called good organization. The crisis is also about replacing real men with political men. Individual passions are no longer possible, only collective, that is to say, abstract passions. Whether we like it or not, we can't avoid politics. It no longer matters that we respect or prevent a mother suffering. What counts is ensuring the triumph of a doctrine. Human suffering is no longer considered a scandal. It is merely one variable in a reckoning whose terrible sum has not yet been calculated. It is clear that these different symptoms can be summed up by something that might be described as the cult of efficiency and abstraction. This is why Europeans today know only solitude and silence. They can no longer communicate with others through shared values. And since they are no longer protected by mutual respect based on those values, their only alternative is to become victims or executioners. This is what the men and women of my generation have understood. This is the crisis they faced and are still facing. We attempted to solve it with the values at our disposal, by which I mean no values at all other than an awareness of the absurdity of our lives. It was in this frame of mind that we were introduced to war and terror with no consolation or certainty. We only knew we could not yield to the brutes taking charge in the four corners of Europe, but we had no idea how to justify our resistance. Even the most lucid among us realized they knew of no principle in whose name they could oppose terror and repudiate murder. For if one believes in nothing, if nothing makes sense and one is unable to affirm any value, then everything is permitted and nothing is important. Hence, there is neither good nor evil, and Hitler was neither wrong nor right. One could lead millions of innocents to the crematorium as easily as one may devote oneself to curing leprosy. One can tear a man's ears with one hand and soothe him with the other. One can clean house in front of men who have just been tortured. One can honor the dead or throw them in the garbage. It is all the same. And since we thought that nothing made sense, we had to conclude that the man who succeeds is in the right. And this is so true that even today, plenty of intelligent skeptics will tell you that if Hitler had by chance won the war, history would have paid him homage and consecrated the hideous pedestal on which he perched. And there can be no doubt that history, as we conceive of it today, would have consecrated Hitler and justified terror and murder, just as we all consecrate and justify murder and terror when we have the temerity to think that everything is meaningless. Some among us, it is true, did think it might be possible, in the absence of any higher values, to believe that history had meaning. In any case, they often acted as if they thought so. They said that this war was necessary because it would liquidate the era of nationalisms and prepare for a time when empires would finally give way, with or without a fight, to universal society and heaven on earth. With this thought, they came to the same conclusion we did. Nothing made sense. For if history has meaning, that meaning must be total or be nothing at all. These men thought and acted as if history obeyed some transcendent dialectic, as if we were all moving together towards some definite goal. They thought and acted according to Hegel's detestable principle, man is made for history, not history for man. In truth, the political and moral realism that holds sway in today's world is heir to a Germanic philosophy of history according to which all of humanity is on the march, moving rationally toward a definitive universe. Nihilism has been replaced by absolute rationalism, and in both cases, the results are the same. For if it is true that history obeys a transcendent and inevitable logic, if it is true, according to this German philosophy, that the feudal state must replace the state of anarchy, that nation states must replace feudalism, and that empires must then take the place of nation states until at last they lead to the creation of a universal society, then anything supporting this inevitable process is good, and the achievements of history are definitive truths. And since these achievements can only be obtained by the usual means of wars, conspiracies, and individual and mass murders, actions cannot be justified on the basis of good or evil, but only by how efficient they are. And so in today's world, the men and women of my generation have been lured by a double temptation, thinking that nothing is true or thinking that only the inevitable forces of history are true. Many of them succumbed to one or the other of these temptations, which is how the world came to be ruined by the will to power, ruled by the will to power and consequently terror. For if nothing is true or false, good or bad, and if the only value is efficiency, the rule of the day is to be the most efficient, meaning the strongest. The world is no longer divided into the just and unjust, but into masters and slaves. He who is right is he who enslaves. The housekeeper is right, not the victims of torture. The German officer who tortures and the one who executes, the SS men transformed into grave diggers, these are the reasonable men of this new world. Look around you and see if it isn't still the case. Violence has a stranglehold on us. Inside every nation and in the world at large, mistrust, resentment, greed, and the race for power are manufacturing a dark, desperate universe in which each man is condemned to live within the limits of the present. The very notion of a future fills him with anguish, for he is captive to abstract powers, starved and confused by harried living, and estranged from nature's truths, from sensible leisure and simple happiness. Perhaps you who dwell in this still happy America do not see this or cannot see it clearly. But the men I am talking about have been seeing it for years and have felt this evil in their flesh, read it on the faces of those they love, and deep in their ailing hearts, a terrible revolt will rise up that will sweep everything away. They are still haunted by too many monstrous images to imagine it will be easy to do, but they are too deeply marked by the horror of those years to allow it to continue. Here's where their true problem begins. If the features of this crisis are the will to power, terror, the replacement of real man by political and historical man, the reign of abstraction and fatality, and solitude without a future, then these are the features we have to change if we want to resolve the crisis. Our generation found itself faced with this immense problem and all that it negated. We had to draw the strength to fight from these very negations. It was perfectly useless to tell us you must believe in God or in Plato or in Marx, precisely because we did not have that kind of faith. The only question was whether we were going to accept a world in which we could only be a victim or an executioner. Of course, we wanted to be neither, because we knew in the bottom of our hearts that this distinction was an illusion, and that when it came down to it, there were only victims, since killing and being killed would amount to the same thing in the end. The murderers and the murdered would all eventually suffer the same defeat. The problem was no longer whether to accept or reject this condition and this world, but rather to know what reason we might have to oppose it. This is why we have looked for our reasons in the very revolt that led us, for no apparent reason, to choose to fight evil. And we understood that we were rebelling not only for ourselves, but for something shared by all men. How did this happen? In this world stripped of values, in this desert of the heart in which we dwelled, what in fact could revolt signify? It made us into people who said no. But at the same time, we were people who said yes. We said no to the world, to its essential absurdity, to the abstractions that threatened us, to the civilization of death that was being prepared for us. By saying no, we declared that things had lasted long enough and there was a line that could not be crossed. But at the same time, we affirmed everything that fell short of that line. We affirmed that there was something within us that rejected the scandal of human suffering and could not be humiliated for too long. Of course, this contradiction should have given us pause. We thought the world existed and struggled without any real values. And yet there we were in a struggle against Germany. The French I knew in the resistance, who read Montaigne in the trains while smuggling their pamphlets, proved that we could, at least in our country, understand the skeptics while retaining a sense of honor. And all of us, consequently, by virtue of the simple fact that we lived, hoped, and fought, were affirming something. But did this something have general value? Was it more than the opinion of an individual, and could it serve as a rule of conduct? The response is quite simple. The men I am speaking about were ready to die in the course of their revolt. Death would prove that they sacrificed themselves for a truth greater than their individual existence and that exceeded their individual destinies. What our rebels were defending against a hostile fate was a value common to all people. When men were tortured in the presence of their housekeeper, when ears were hacked with diligence, when mothers were forced to condemn their children to death, when the just were buried like pigs, these men in revolt judged that something in them was being denied. Something that belonged not only to them, but was a common good through which all men could achieve solidarity. Yes, that was the great lesson of those disastrous years, that an insult aimed at a student in Prague affected a worker in the Paris suburbs, that blood spilled somewhere on the banks of an Eastern European river could lead a Texas farmer to spill his own on the ground of the Ardennes forest he'd only just got to know. And even this was absurd and crazy, impossible or nearly impossible to contemplate. But at the same time, there was in that absurdity the lesson that we found ourselves in a collective tragedy where a sense of shared dignity was at stake, a communion among men that had to be defended and sustained. With that in mind, we knew how to act, and we learned that people, even in situations of absolute moral degradation, can find sufficient values to guide their conduct. Once people began to realize that the truth lay in communicating with each other and mutual recognition of each other's dignity, it became clear that this very communication was what had to be served. To maintain this communication, men needed to be free, since a master and a slave have nothing in common. And one cannot speak and communicate with a slave. Yes, bondage is a silence, the most terrible silence of all. To maintain this communication, we had to eliminate injustice, because there is no contact between the oppressed and the profiteer. Need is also relegated to silence. To maintain this communication, we had to eliminate lying and violence. For the man who lies closes himself off from other men, and he who tortures and constrains imposes an irrevocable silence. From the negative impetus that was the starting point of our revolt, we drew an ethos of liberty and sincerity. Yes, it was the act of communication that was needed to oppose the murderous world. That's what we understood going forward, and this communication must be maintained today if we are to protect ourselves from murder. As we know now, we must fight against injustice, against slavery and terror, because these three scourges are what makes silence reign among men, what builds barriers between them, what renders them invisible to one another and prevents them from finding the only value that might save them from this desperate world, the extended brotherhood of men struggling against fate. At the end of this long night, we finally know that what we must do in the face of this crisis-torn world. What must we do? Call things by their name and understand that that when we kill millions of people, each time we agree to think certain thoughts. You don't think badly because you're a murderer. You are a murderer because you think badly. Hence, you can be a murderer without ever having killed. And this is why we are all, more or less, murderers. The first thing to do is simply to reject, in thought and action, any acquiescent or fatalistic way of thinking. The second thing to do is to unburden the world of the terror that reigns today and prevents clear thought. And since I've been told that the United Nations is holding an important session in this very city, we might suggest that the first written text of this global organization should solemnly proclaim, in the wake of the Nuremberg trials, a worldwide abolition of capital punishment. The third thing to do, whenever possible, is to put politics back in its true place, a secondary one. We need not furnish the world with a political or moral gospel or catechism. The great misfortune of our time is precisely that politics pretends to provide us with a catechism, with a complete philosophy, and sometimes even with rules for loving. But the role of politics is to keep things in order and not to regulate our inner problems. As for me, I don't know if there exists any absolute. If there is one, I know it is not of a political order. The absolute is not something we can decide on as a whole. It's for each of us to think about individually. Each of us should have the inner freedom to reflect on the meaning of the absolute. And our external relationships should allow us that freedom. Our life undoubtedly belongs to others, and it is right to sacrifice it if necessary. But our death belongs only to us. This is my definition of freedom. The fourth thing to be done is to seek out and to create, on the very foundation of our negativity, positive values that will reconcile negative thought with the potential for positive action. That is the work of philosophers, which I have barely touched upon here. The fifth thing is to fully understand that this attitude means creating a universalism in which all people of goodwill can come together. To leave solitude behind, we must speak, but we must always speak frankly, and on all occasions never lie and always say everything we know to be true. But we can only speak the truth in a world in which it is defined and founded on values shared by everyone. It isn't Mr. Hitler who decides what's true or false. Nobody in this world, now or ever, should have the right to decide that their own truth is good enough to impose on others. For only the shared consciousness of men and women can realize this ambition. The value sustaining this shared consciousness must be rediscovered. The freedom we must finally win is the freedom not to lie. Only then can we discover our reasons for living and for dying. So here's where we stand. And I probably took the long way there, but after all, the history of mankind is the history of its errors, not its truth. Truth is probably like happiness, simple and without a history. Does this mean we've resolved all of our problems? No, of course not. The world is neither better nor more reasonable. We still haven't left absurdity behind. But we have at least one reason to force ourselves to change our behavior, and this is the reason we've been missing. The world would still be a desperate place if men and women didn't exist. But they do, along with their passions, their dreams, and their communion. A few of us in Europe have combined a pessimistic view of the world with a profound optimism for humankind. We can't pretend to escape from history, for we are in history. We can only aspire to do battle in the arena of history to save from it that part of man which does not belong to it. We want only to rediscover the paths to a civilization where man, without turning his back on history, will no longer be enslaved by it, where the obligation each person incurs with regard to others will be balanced by time for reflection, pleasure, and the happiness every person owes themselves. I would venture to say that we will always refuse to worship events, facts, wealth, power, history as it unfolds, and whatever the world becomes. We want to see the human condition for what it is. We know what it is. It's this terrible condition that takes truckloads of blood and centuries of history to arrive at some imperceptible shift in human destiny. Such is the law. For years during the 18th century, heads fell like hail in France. The French Revolution inflamed all hearts with enthusiasm and terror. Eventually, at the start of the next century, we ended up replacing traditional monarchy with constitutional monarchy. We who live in France in the 20th century know this terrible law only too well. It took war, the occupation, massacres, 1,000 prison walls, and a Europe racked by grief for a few of us to finally grasp two or three insights that might slightly diminish our despair. In a situation like ours, optimism seems scandalous. We know that those of us who are dead today were the best among us, since they appointed themselves. And we who are still living must remind ourselves that we are only alive because we did less than others. And this is why we continue to live a contradiction. The only difference is that this generation can now join this contradiction to an immense hope for humankind. Since I wanted to tell you something about French sensibility, it will suffice that you remember this. Today in France and in Europe, there is a generation who thinks that anyone who places his hopes in the human condition is mad, but that anyone who despairs of events is a coward. This generation refuses absolute explanations and the rule of political philosophies, but wishes to affirm men and women in their flesh and in their striving for liberty. This generation does not believe the achievement of universal happiness and satisfaction is possible, but it does believe in diminishing human sorrow. It is because the world is, in its essence, unhappy that we need to create some joy. Because the world is unjust, we need to work towards justice. And because the world is absurd, we must provide it with all its meaning. In the end, what does it all mean? It means that we must be modest in our thoughts and our actions, stand our ground, and do our best work. It means that we must create communities and thought outside parties and governments in order to foster dialogue across national borders. The members of these communities will affirm by their lives and their words that this world must cease to be the world of police, soldiers, and money, and become the world of men and women, of fruitful work and thoughtful leisure. This is where I think we ought to direct our efforts, our thinking, and if necessary, our sacrifice. The corruption of the ancient world began with the murder of Socrates, and we killed many of him in Europe over these few years. That is a sign. It's a sign that only a Socratic spirit of indulgence toward others and rigor towards oneself can truly threaten murderous civilizations. It's a sign that only this frame of mind can repair the world. All other efforts, however admirable, that rely on power and domination can only mutilate men and women more grievously. This, in any case, is the modest revolution that we French and Europeans are experiencing now. Perhaps you're surprised that a French writer on an official visit to America does not feel obligated to present you with some idyllic portrait of his country, and has made no effort thus far to offer what is generally called propaganda. But perhaps when you reflect on the issues I have raised, it will seem obvious why. Propaganda, I suppose, is designed to provoke in people feelings that they don't possess. But the French people who have shared our experience ask neither to be pitied nor loved by decree. The only national problem of concern to them was not dependent on world opinion. For 5 years, what mattered to us was to know if we could save our honor. That is, if we could preserve the right to speak for ourselves the day the war was over. We weren't looking to anyone else to grant us this right. We needed to grant it to ourselves. This was not easy, but in the end, if we did give ourselves this right, it is because we know, and we are the only ones who know, the true extent of our sacrifices. Yet we are not entitled to give lessons. We have only the right to escape the humiliating silence of those who were beaten and vanquished because they disdained humankind for too long. Beyond this, I ask you to believe that we will know how to keep our place. Perhaps, as some have said, there is indeed a chance that the history of the next 50 years will be made in part by nations other than France. I have no personal opinion on this question. I know only that our nation, which lost 1,620,000 men a quarter century ago, and which has just lost several hundred thousands more volunteers, must recognize that it has exhausted, or allowed others to exhaust, its strength. That is a fact. And the opinion of the world, its consideration, or its disdain cannot change that fact. That is why it would seem to me ludicrous to solicit or try to affect it. But it does not seem ludicrous to me to underline how the present world crisis stems from these quarrels about precedence and power. To summarize this evening, and speaking now for myself, I would like to say just this. Whenever we judge France or any other country or any matter in terms of power, we are aiding and abetting a conception of man that leads inevitably to his mutilation. We are reinforcing the thirst for domination, and we are headed toward the sanctioning of murder. What goes for the world of action goes for ideas. And those who say or write that the end justifies the means, those who say and write that greatness is measured by force, they are absolutely responsible for the atrocious accumulation of crimes disfiguring contemporary Europe. I think I've expressed everything I felt duty-bound to tell you. My duty was to remain faithful to the voices and the experiences of our European comrades so that you not be tempted to judge them out of hand. For they sit in judgment over no one. No one, that is, except the murderers. And they regard all nations with the hope and certitude that these are capable of finding the human truth that each contains. Speaking in particular to the young Americans in the audience this evening, I can say that the people I have spoken about have great respect for your humanity and your taste for freedom and happiness, which can be discerned on the faces of great Americans. Yes, they expect from you what they expect of all men of goodwill, a loyal contribution to the spirit of dialogue that they want to infuse the world with. Our struggles, our hopes, and our demands, seen from afar, may appear confused or futile to you. And it is true that on the road to wisdom and truth, if there is one, these men have not chosen the straightest or the simplest path. This is because neither the world nor history have offered them anything straightforward or simple. They are trying to forge with their own hands the secret they could not find in their given condition. And perhaps they will fail. But I am convinced that if they fail, so will the world. In a Europe still poisoned by violence and deep-seated hatred, in a world torn apart by terror, they try to save for mankind what can still be saved. And that is their only ambition. If such an effort can find some expression in France, and if this evening I have been able to give you even a faint idea of the passion for justice that inspires all French people, it will be our sole consolation and my humblest source of pride. Thank you.
I've beaten all the Facebook of my children.
So what are we going to do?
I will be reintroducing myself.
Excellent.
I've been introduced earlier. So I am Souleymane Bachir Diagne. I'm the chair of French. And it is my privilege to say a few words of welcome following my friend Shanny Pierre earlier. The way 70 years ago, the chair of French then welcomed the audience who filled this amphitheater to hear and see Albert Camus deliver his lecture on La Crise de l'Homme. My role is going to be that of a moderator, which means that I will ask a couple of questions to Alice Kaplan and then to Viggo Mortensen, to whom I express one more time my gratitude for his presence and his generosity. But before I pose a couple of questions to Alice and then to Viggo Mortensen, allow me to make two general remarks. My first remark is to say that obviously our primary reason for gathering here is to reenact, and this has been wonderfully done, to revive and to repeat in some celebratory way the event which took place in this very theater 70 years ago. But I believe that beyond the sheer ritual of marking a remarkable anniversary, it can also be said that there is a deeper reason why Albert Camus speaks to us today in 2016. A reason why we think and feel that he is, in our present times, facing and answering the questions that torment us. And that phrase is a quote. I'm making here a quote from the article entitled Albert Camus Militant, that Justin O'Brien, then a chair of the French Department of Columbia, wrote in the month following the death of the author of The Stranger in 1961. I was talking earlier to my neighbor and asking myself, why is it that Camus, in some respect, is back? And I believe that the lecture we just heard, the speech reenacted so beautifully by Viggo Mortensen, has an answer to that question. The statement that Camus faces and answers the question that torment us is even truer, I believe, today than when that was written in 1961 by Justin O'Brien. He declared, as we just heard, that we should think against Hegel's detestable principe, as he says in French, the dreadful principle that man is made for history and not history for man. With the consequence then that violence has a stranglehold on us as we are lured to believe that only the forces of history are true. All these have been emphasized again earlier by Viggo Mortensen. That belief led to different statements affirming the value of anti-humanism and the legitimacy of violence as the midwife of history, to quote here Engels, and as the promise of emancipation and a universal society. At the time when Camus was saying this, actually the majority of French intellectuals, French philosophers, fresh out of Second World War, and either members of the French Communist Party or compagnons de route of the French Communist Party did believe in that Hegelian heinous or detestable principle. So Camus' voice was easily then covered by those who spoke from within the Hegel-Engels-Marx paradigm of the necessity of violence. That is not the case anymore, I believe, as his call to restore humanism now and to never sanctify and justify murder and terror by allowing ourselves to believe that everything is meaningless resonates powerfully today, probably after the collapse of so-called real socialism and the destruction of the war of Berlin. So probably this is why, especially the last sentences of the Crise de l'Homme that were just read, resonate with us today in 2016 in a way that it did not so much at the time with the French intellectuals back home. Which brings me to my second remark, which I am going to transform also into a question to Alice. When Camus visited the US in 1946, he was known mainly as the author of The Stranger, which was translated at the same time. Yeah.
I don't think it had been published yet.
It had not been published yet. It would take another couple of months or so for
the students would have known about it.
It was published on April 11th.
Okay.
So about 12 days. And it was, in some sense, are you ready for an answer to your question? It seems like you have more.
Yes, but please connect it with the second part of my question, which is to say that although he was the author of The Stranger, and I referred to him earlier as the author of The Stranger.
Yeah.
It seems to me that the Camus that resonates with us today is probably more, and I want to know if you would be agreeing, is probably more the Camus of the plague, La Peste, as the novel is precisely this exemplification of that line earlier read about the brotherhood of human beings who are facing and opposing and combating the notion of fate. And the plague and these admirable people who face the plague, saving humanity, civilization, mankind, humanism, against this blind fatality of history or the plague, is probably something that is what resonates with us today, what makes Camus so present in our lives today. And I would like to have, as my first question to you, Alice, your reaction to that.
No, I agree with you very much. I mean, he came to launch The Stranger, but he had, as we say, he had moved on. I mean, he had experienced. He'd written The Stranger in a very isolated place. It was inspired in 1939 by the mean streets of Algiers. He finished it alone in a hotel room in Montmartre. And then he had this incredible experience of the resistance and collective work and the newspaper Combat. And I think when Viggo Mortensen said that one line, the beast is dead, but the venom isn't gone, that was really Camus' plague message. I don't know if you remember the very last paragraph of the plague bacillus lies dormant. It lies dormant in our furniture, in our closets, and may come any time. So it's this sort of vigilance about evil after the experience of World War II. Yeah.
One second question. We were reminded that he was just, you said it in your introduction, he was just 32 when he came to this country.
Yeah.
And the crisis of La Crise de l'Homme, or the human crisis, came very early in his works. What is the presence of this text, this speech he gave here at Columbia, mm-hmm. in the rest of his work?
I really think it's a blueprint for everything he wrote after. The rebel and the plague are full of elements. The fall has that story. He was really struck by that story of the mother who has to choose which child to save. And of course, we all know this as Sophie's Choice. I'm not sure if Styron was inspired by it, but it shows up in the fall, it shows up in the rebel. And this idea of evil continuing. I mean, the idea of being neither a victim or an executioner is also all over his work. He wrote a series of articles in Combat with that title. So it was a very, very important speech.
Okay, one last question. We are expecting your work to come, your book on Camus, and I understand that writing a book now on Camus is an invitation to read Camus.
Yes.
Why? Why should we read him now, and what do you think we should be reading?
I think that there's a Camus for every phase of life. So, I mean, he's your companion for all of life. When you're an adolescent and feeling alienated, you have The Stranger. And then when you go to college and you become a humanitarian and you have, you know, political feelings, you read The Plague as a manual of commitment. And then when you're midlife, you know, you have to pick up The Fall, because Clemence, well, he's a lawyer, but he could have been in charge of a hedge fund. And then when you're a little older, you can look at The First Man, because it's very much Camus' remembrance of things past. It's something to read when things grow quieter around you. But I have to say that my students now read Camus differently than students would have in the 40s and 50s. They don't read him, you know, in the existentialist box. They read him in history. They read him as somebody who grew up in Algeria, who was in the resistance. They love The First Man, and they love the beautiful lyrical essays on Algeria. And I think that's very good. They read him as Camus and not just as an existentialist.
Speaking of which, he always protested that
he
was not an existentialist.
Yeah, he hated it.
And the father of French existentialism, if you can call Jean-Paul Sartre that way, did also explain why Camus was not an existentialist. So why do we still say?
I think it might be the fault of Blanche Knopf. I mean, he was really marketed as an existentialist. I think he once said that he and Sartre had agreed to put an ad in the paper saying that they were not responsible for any debts they had incurred mutually.
Thank you, Alice. Now that you have caught your breath back, I was among the happy few who were at the screening of this wonderful movie that has been adapted from a short story by Albert Camus, L'Hôte, The Guest. and in which you play the major role of Daru, and there is this wonderful friendship between Daru and Mohammed that you talked about. In your introductory remarks before we started seeing the movie, you mentioned that you had a deep respect for a long time for Camus. And I wanted at that time to just ask, when did you meet with Camus' work, personality, and discovered what he meant for you?
The first thing I read an English translation of The Stranger, and when I was finishing high school, secondary school. And then at university, I reread it in French, and then other things, La Peste, Caligula, Les Justes, and so on. The more I read, the more I admired him, and I think it was more, it wasn't so much like an intellectual appreciation. I wasn't, at that time, initially putting him, contextualizing him in history, or, although we did in university talk about Gide and Sartre and many other writers, which was part of the study, having to discuss that. I was specifically interested in his point of view, that there was a certain stubbornness about his point of view, I sensed, and this was before thinking about it too deeply. I liked his, he had sort of this outsider view, I felt, and he sort of dared to say no. Where other people, and then I started to learn more about how he had been accepted and not accepted by some of the people that have been mentioned in France, his fellow travelers and people who eventually, when he started to speak out against specifically the Soviet Union and other forms of totalitarianism and the machinery, which he refers to in his speech and in other places, he was castigated for that by a certain part of the left. And I found that interesting, and the fact that he had the courage to keep speaking and eventually to not speak. He had the courage to not speak and say, I'm not going to defend myself. I'm just going to carry on with what I'm doing, which is to say no. Under any circumstances to war and violence and murder that was consistent. And I think in many ways, not just artistically, in terms of themes of his work that you referred to and that you also referred to, that there's this resurgence or that it comes around again, except in France to some degree, because one thing I also experienced firsthand, when we presented, one of the great things about the story of the production of Loin des Hommes, this movie that we made based on a short story, which for those of you who haven't seen it, it's the central characters are two Algerians, two men born in Algeria in the exact same region. One is an Arab and one is a Pied-Noir, a descendant of Europeans. Both are born there. They have a similar accent. They have an almost identical understanding of the landscape, etc. With the exception that the character I play has been, not much, but he's been outside the country because he fought in the war and so forth. But these two characters represent something that has to do with all his work, that you have to find a way to say no to violence, to say no to murder, to work. There must be some way. And even if there isn't, you must try. You owe it to yourself, if you're going to be truthful, to resist becoming basically nothing, becoming a robot and just being at the whim of history, what he rejected. men make history, history does not make men. It was his feeling even in this story. And I found that when we presented this story about this unusual, unexpected friendship between an Arab and a European, a man of European descent, in France, I was looking forward to it, and we had already presented it in other places, including in Morocco and Algeria, a place where two countries that have, there's a lot of conflict, has been for decades between the governments. What I had found in visiting those places and in working with our crew, which was made of Moroccans, Algerians, French, myself, others, that people got along. And the people, when I asked them, well, what about this problem on the border of Morocco and Algeria? What about all these political differences? I found, by and large, that people didn't really have that much of a problem. It was a problem created, you know, for nefarious reasons by politicians, by the machine, you know. And so this movie was made by this mixed group of people, and it was shown, it has been shown in Algeria, Morocco, Palestine, Israel, United States, everywhere. I only found in France's neighbor in Spain, it had probably the best reception I've ever seen, and Camus is admired there and respected, even on the left, for the things that you underline, that your students are interested in, you know, not that there isn't some ideological opposition to him, unthinking, inherited ideological opposition to him. In France, however, I found among certain journalists on the left, a certain part of the left, that there was a resistance to even talking about the movie. I mean, this was a movie near the near an important date, near centennial of Camus, and there was a lot of activity, a lot of book sales, and you know, he's the best selling author, I think, in France still, right? But there were a lot of reasons to pay some attention to this movie. Reda Kateb, the actor who plays Mohammed in it, is very well known right now. He's an award-winning, very respected actor. And Camus is always a source of interest in France. And the fact that I was working in the movie to some degree, yeah, I'm doing it in France and Arabic and all that, there were reasons to write about it, to do, you know. And yet, there were several newspapers, they didn't even want to write about it. They didn't even put a review, or if they did, it was just in passing. And then a lot of the interviews I did, there was interesting questions where they would sort of imply, and I was just cut right to it. I said, you're trying to talk to me as I guess a disciple of Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir. You don't like Camus, right? Why don't you just say it? But does that mean you don't like our movie? Is that, I mean, you know, it's just this rigid, I'm like, well, I did not say this. But that's, I think that's what you're saying. And I don't even know if this article is going to appear in your newspaper. And sometimes it did, sometimes it didn't. And it was interesting, you know. But the people that did see it, the movie happened to be released there right same week as the Charlie Hebdo murders. And so it was like,
jeez.
And to those who did see it, they felt it was instructive, unexpected, thought-provoking to see a story that's about a friendship between an Arab and a European, a descendant of Europeans, you know, a Catholic man and a Muslim man at that moment, you know. And I do think that, I don't know, I'm going off on a long ramble, but the thing in France is troubling to me, that there still is this thing that happens there with Camus. There's this certain resentment toward him, a feeling that he's reactionary, that he betrayed his comrades or his ideals, and that he was a coward in terms of Algeria. And I don't think that's at all true. All you have to do is read some of the things that your students have been reading, the Algerian Chronicles, and mm-hmm. so many other things that prove that that's not the case. Anyway, sorry about that ramble.
You're yourself an activist. It has been recalled earlier that you oppose war. And speaking of people who recent Albert Camus, thinking also that it takes naivety, really, to have this kind of opposition in principle to any kind of war, violence, etc., and even saying, as he famously said, I prefer my mother to justice. Mm-hmm. Justice implying violence, something that has to be
well, killed. But that, as you know, that was taken out of context. It was right. Just saying my mother and not revolution.
Exactly. Yeah.
And what he was really saying is if justice means the murder of civilians, then I'm against justice. Because that's not justice.
Yeah, actually, the right? sentence that they reconstructed was, people are planting bombs in tramways in Algiers. My mother might be on one of those tramways. And if that's the case, it doesn't matter what the cause is, I prefer my mother to
justice. Which is what you
justice.
Find in that, in Les Justes,
mm-hmm. yeah.
the terrorist who stops.
Yeah.
Because
he sees
he has
the
met
eyes.
The eyes of the child in the carriage of the archduke.
That sentence is the most abused sentence, isn't mm-hmm. it? It's people just are thoughtless. They just trot it out.
Sartreans are.
But I remember the day before I was to meet the director of that movie, because he had just said, well, you know, I heard you someone told me you maybe speak some French, and could you do a movie in French? And here's the script. I said, it's a great script, but, you know, let's meet, and you can decide. If you don't think I'm up to it, then fine. So I got to Paris the day before, and I was walking along the river, and, you know, all those booksellers, and I found this, I think it was like a first edition paperback. It was pretty messed up of... I think it was The Myth of Sisyphus, and I thought, oh, that's great. And I wanted to get, and the guy goes, the guy that was selling the book. I said, oh, it's not for sale? He goes, you want to buy this? And I'm like, well, I was thinking about it. How much is it? Why you want to buy this? And I'm like, well, I'm interested. I admire the author. I admire the author, and how much is it? Why you want to buy this? You know nothing. You people come. You come from, you know, you come from wherever you come from, and you think that Cameron is great. And he was this tirade. He was like furious. And he was a traitor to the revolution. And all this, and I'm like, no, he's actually a good. We started to have this conversation. Argument. And I finally said, okay, I have to go, I have to meet someone, but I'd love to buy the book. And then he was like, yeah. I said, well, I mean, do you want to give it to me?
No.
Said, how much? And I don't know what it was, I think it was €8 or something. And so I gave him that and walked away. But he was so
idiot
as I was walking, as I walked away, you know.
Fool.
And this is still happening. And this was a guy. This is a guy who was. I would say. I mean, he was probably not much older than me. So this has been passed down. This, that sentence. Yeah. That he spoke when he accepted the Nobel Prize. It was twisted, and so many other things. They've been inherited by a certain part of the left. Just mainly in part, it's a resentment of his because he's such a. Best-selling author. I don't know
so
how much
strange.
Of that has to do with jealousy.
So strange.
I felt in reading some of the things, some of the lies, frankly, of de Beauvoir and Sartre, that it wasn't that I thought that there was a degree of professional jealousy involved, not just
even personally. It has been said that Sartre resented the fact that Camus was so good-looking as well. But
it's possible.
But
can I just say in defense of Sartre that Sartre came and lectured in 45. He went to Yale and Harvard, and he presented Camus. He really rolled out a red carpet for Camus. He said, this guy is the future of French letters, this sort of somber classicism. And it wasn't until he was a very old man that he started ranting and saying, oh, that fool, he thought the Nazism was like a plague.
Yeah, but he jumped on him when he published The Rebel. Yeah.
That was the beginning of the end. Yeah.
But
there was the good, there was the honeymoon moment in 45.
Well, and Sartre was quite sincere In the same way, I believe he was also very sincere in the beautiful eulogy he wrote for
Camus.
That was amazing.
He came back to his true, I believe, feelings vis-a-vis Camus when he wrote that wonderful piece.
But he said
Camus,
quarreling is one way of being together, right?
Yeah. I must confess that actually I decided to study philosophy because of the influence of Sartre. So at that time, I was more on the side of Sartre, and I wanted to think of myself as being on the side of revolution then. Mm-hmm. And probably my attraction to Camus now comes also with gray hair. So it has to do with that. I was happy to hear you say that among the books by Camus, the works by Camus you read very early and you liked, there was my favorite, which is Caligula. The play Caligula, and you mentioned Camus' stubbornness. Mm-hmm. This Caligula coming on scene and just saying, "I want the moon." I think this says very much about what has been called Camus' naivete, wanting the moon, which probably defines our human condition in some way. Never stop wanting the moon. And this leads me to my last question. I wanted to ask you if there is any character from Camus that you would like to play.
I don't know. I mean, having in Blandizome, I got to play an interesting character that was, in many ways, I imagined, and so did the director, that this was Camus in some sense, if you could imagine him not having had that fantastic success with his first novel, not having left Algeria, maybe he would have, because there was something of a plain-spoken teacher about him, you know, that he could have become something like the character in that movie. And certainly his sort of stubborn point of view of, like, wanting nothing to do with violence, trying to get away from it, trying to convince his partner in the story to reject it, you know, to choose life at all times. I enjoyed that a lot. As far as I hadn't thought about it. I mean, I really enjoyed reading The First Man, you know, the posthumous novel, the novel that was found, manuscript in the trunk of the car he died in. There was a movie made of that also, in my opinion, it was sort of a wasted opportunity, but maybe it could be made again or something. It wasn't well made, but that's an amazing book that has so many things in it. It's almost like, I mean, I don't suppose he could have known he was going to die. I mean, he knew he was going to die like we all do. But so soon, but there was such a summing up in that book, you know, and he wasn't that old. I mean, he was still in his 40s when he died. And yet there's a real, as I say, summing up and a wisdom that normally comes from someone who maybe is fortunate enough to reach their 80s or something and then is able to look back in that way that I think it's Schopenhauer described, where everything that seems so chaotic, but if you reach that age, it looks back and it's like a novel. All the pieces seem to make a certain amount of sense. But that book is amazing. I don't know. I don't know. I'm probably too old to play any of his characters at this point, or just almost, you know. I don't know. I'm very happy with the gift I was given to play Daru. I don't ask for more. It just made me want to read even more. In fact, in preparing for the movie, I really enjoyed not only reading every biography I could find about him, but things I hadn't read all of the Algerian Chronicles. I hadn't read all his journalism work. I had not, at that point, read the correspondence with the poet René Char, and some other things, and I couldn't get enough of it. It looks, when you enjoy your job or what you're learning, it's you know, I was insatiable, and I really enjoyed finding, and so did the director, you know, we shared this, and so did Reda Kateb, the other actor. It was on a daily basis, like, hey, you know, there's this thing he said in this book, or you know what Kateb Yassin said about this, and Kateb Yassin is a, for those of you who don't know, he's a famous writer from Algeria, contemporary of Camus, someone who, like, as happened with Sartre, there was a difference of opinion about whether, you know, about the revolution, about, you know, do the ends justify the means, violence, so forth. They had a difference of opinion, but there was a real respect there, which I think in the end you can say is the same Sartre Camus. But all these things, we would draw on things that he had written in unexpected places, you know, as far as researching the movie, and it was great. I imagine your class, your students are, if they, once they get excited about it, they probably really go to lengths to, is that true? I mean, do they read more than what you assign them when it comes to him? Or not? Or do they have,
well, you know, there's something extraordinary. I mean, you can read, if you're energetic, you can read almost all of Camus' main texts in one academic semester. And so they can, and that's what I try to do, is give them everything. Mm. Yeah. And now I'm going to add the human crisis to my syllabus. Okay. Isn't that beautiful? It was just beautiful. Yeah.
As you know, in the Myth de Sisyphe, he explains that you have a few figures of the tragic hero, and one of the beautiful figures of the tragic hero is the figure of the actor, because they come to play so many roles. Mm-hmm. They are they represent this intensification of life, which was the whole thing about Albert Camus, living life intensely and choosing the side of life, as you said beautifully. So as a tragic hero a la Camus, as an actor, it was a pleasure, an immense pleasure for me to meet you and to thank you again for your generosity. And I would like you to join me in thanking Viggo and Alice again. Thank you. Thank you.
No. Thanks for your patience.
Getting? Thank you.